Trying to figure out what all of these corporate results say about the global economy. You guys have a great global footprint. So 2.5% organic revenue growth. Does it tell us that everything is fine, or is it more of a Mondelez-specific story?
Well, I think if you think about what we are doing as a company, we are a snacking company. And snacking is a category worldwide that is growing quite nicely, different from global food, I would say. And so we have some momentum in our categories itself. And then as you talk about how the consumer is feeling in different countries around the world, we're a basic type of requirement. And in fact, when the consumer is feeling a little bit less good, what's better than a bar of chocolate or a nice biscuit to sort of help you through the day. So we don't tend to be affected that much by slowdowns. And I would say also we have a very good portfolio of products that can cover any needs that the consumer might have.
Wanted to dig in specifically on the Chinese consumer. I saw in the call you said 6 consecutive quarter of growth in China, all categories were up. Talk a little bit about what you're seeing on the ground, given the trade tensions with the U.S. and the slowdown in the Chinese economy.
Yeah, we look at our categories, we look at snacking, and the snacking categories in China are growing well. We are growing our market share in chocolate, in biscuits, our online, because online e-commerce is quite big in China, is growing over 70% in 2018 for us. So we don't necessarily experience in our categories that slowdown of the Chinese economy. And again, I think that has to see with the fact that we're a basic commodity as it relates to what the consumer wants to eat on a day-to-day basis. So we don't tend to be affected that much by it.
What about this issue of pricing in the U.S.? Are we going to be paying more for snacks like Oreos and Triscuits? And exactly how much pricing power do you feel that you have?
Well, yes, we're going to be paying a little bit more, I would call it, because what is happening this year is that the commodities, the input costs that we have, packaging, dairy, they're going up more than in previous years, and we have to reflect that in our pricing. Now, it's not out of this world. It's not a huge jump, but we will pay a little bit more. I do think that we have strong brands. Our main brand is Oreo, as an example. It's growing 7% in 2018 in the U.S. We see a lot more repeat buying from the consumer on Oreo. So Oreo as a brand, as an example, we have several others like Ritz or Chips Ahoy that are doing quite well. And so we believe there is the momentum, there's the consumer interest, there's the connection to our brands that they will accept a small price increase on our products.
You know, I know that you don't characterize yourself necessarily as a food company, because snacking does better than food, mm-hmm. but even among some of the snacking yes. peers, it looks like you're outperforming in terms of sales. I'm thinking Kellogg, Hershey results today. Are you taking share? And if so, how? What's the competitive environment like?
Well, I assume you're talking about the U.S. And yes, in the U.S. we are taking share, largely in the biscuits category. We have what we call a DSD system, which allows us to go directly to the store. So we're in contact every day with many, many stores across the U.S. And that gives us a competitive advantage, and that allows us to execute better in those stores. As I said, I think our brands are having some momentum. Oreo is one of the best loved brands by millennials. And so I think that's another competitive advantage that we have. And then we offer quite a range of different products, so that we offer the consumer quite a bit of choice. And I think it's all those elements that allow us to do quite well in the U.S. environment at the moment.
Hey, Dirk, you know, there's a school of thought. It applies mostly to packaged good companies. But the idea goes input costs are either coming down or not going up as much as they were before. And in the meantime, a lot of these pricing increases at retail have already happened, and that's going to spell a good story for margins in the year ahead. Does that apply to you?
I see that slightly different, to be honest. What I see is that the input cost this year, they go up every year. But compared to 2018, our input costs are clearly going up more than it has been. And as a consequence, we're pricing just to maintain, maybe slightly increase our margin, but it's not going to be a story where, because input costs are lower than expected, we will see a big boom in our margins. That is not what we're seeing at the moment.
You have a big business in Europe, Dirk. How do you even prepare for a no-deal Brexit? I mean, there's not a deal on the table, and I know the market is not expecting that the UK crashes out of the EU, but if it does, what sort of disruption and cost pressures are you going to face?
Well, it is quite important, and the difficulty about it is that you can't really tell what's going to happen. It can go from a hard Brexit to a more softer or a postponement of Brexit. One thing is for sure, whatever happens, the flow of products in and out of the UK will be affected. So we have to prepare for that, which means we need to rent more trucks, we need to rent more warehouses, we need to build up inventories of raw materials and packaging materials. So all of that together has extra cost, and we're already prepared for that. But if we would go to a hard Brexit, as an example, that could be accompanied by a devaluation of the British pound. That could be accompanied by tariffs being put. And like any other company, I would assume we ship products in the UK which are produced on the mainland, or we ship products out of the UK which have to be sold on the mainland. So if it would be a hard Brexit, that has a number of collateral effects. We're preparing for those, but that would be quite substantial. On the longer term, I think, I'm talking about short-term and mid-term effects, I think on the longer term that will stabilize and consumption will come back to the normal level. So longer term, I don't think we'll see major effects. Short term, very dependent on what type of Brexit we are going to see. The effects could be wide-ranging. And after yesterday's vote, I have high hopes that we will go to a softer Brexit, an agreement, and that it all will not be as bad as it potentially could be.
Finally, I hope you won't mind one fun question, Dirk. We talked about Oreos earlier. I saw a study a few months ago that Oreo Double Stuff is not necessarily double the volume of cream filling of a regular Oreo. Is that true?
What?
Well, I can't really answer that question. I don't know exactly how much double stuff is in there. But we are at the moment launching a new promotion, which is Oreo the most stuff ever, which is double the double. And I can tell you that is the most stuff you've ever seen in an Oreo.
Personally, I prefer the dark chocolate stuff. But finally, Dirk, you know, 2018 was your first full year as CEO, and you opened up to us at the Investor Day last year and had all sorts of ideas and strategies that you're going to put in place, investments that you're going to make, and staying local, for instance, when it comes to snacks. Where are you in the transformation right now of Mondelez?
We delivered a good year. As a new CEO, that was quite important for me. Deliver what I promised we would do, and we kind of over-delivered. And so I'm pretty happy about that. Secondly, we developed this new strategy, which was done by the middle of the year. And we started to implement all the things that you mentioned. And they're causing traction. We ended the year well. In our industry, we look largely at organic growth, which was 2.5%. Which we haven't seen for a while for our company. What's more important, we want that growth to come from volume. We want people to eat more physically of our products, and that was one of the first years in a long time that we've seen that on our products. We are activating a number of things, new ways of innovating. We are playing more with all the different brands we have around the world. We've increased our investment in R&D. So all that is happening. We're executing the strategy as we planned. And so far, the second half of 18 is showing the results of that. And we're entering 19 quite happy, quite excited. It seems like this thing is going to work. And so we have high hopes that 19 yeah. will be an excellent year for us.